Rock, but at the same time, it's just so spastic in a way that only like a really good robot can be, and call attention to the way it was made as a result of that. But yeah, it's trying to make better things. Such as, I wish we could hear more of this, but I took this, I licensed it. In this case, a punk track by a local group called Burbank Tabernacle Choir, that, because I wanted to get access to the multi-track, so I got this multi-track of this band playing bass, drums, organs, guitars, harmonicas, et cetera, playing this very funky thing. And the thing about funky music is it can be very redundant, but it's I find it really fascinating listening to how precise the relationship is between the players, and this whole time thing again. This idea of laying behind the beat and being on top of the beat and pushing the music and maybe pushing it in a way that makes people want to dance and all that sort of stuff. And being a very millisecond, microsecond kind of relationship between musicians. And when I was commissioned by this group who wear yellow hats called the Danish Ghetto Blaster Ensemble, in conjunction with this local presentation group called Deep Wireless and Sound, I think it was Sound Travels in this case, it seems to be the same thing, to make a piece, I thought, well, let's take that funk groove, that really tight relationship of instruments, break it down into the separate instruments, make a CD for each of these guys with their ghetto blasters, because that's what they were commissioning me to make music for, was them with ghetto blasters. So each person would have either a guitar or a bass, one of the drums, or the left side of the Leslie organ, or the right side of the Leslie organ, on their ghetto blaster. This guy here is the conductor, so it's born and everything, standing there. And his job was to try to get them into that really tight funk relationship groove. I was really surprised when they showed up, because I thought, they come from Denmark, they're going to have like really high-tech, pristine kind of things that they call ghetto blasters, which for some reason, although they probably don't even have ghetto blasters. they had all sorts of different machines that were sort of breaking down and everything, and they were starving artists just like everywhere else. So their machines tended not to play together very well, and as I expected, they wouldn't be able to precisely all start their machines at the same time, but there was even more involved in that because they had all different kinds of machines. It was the conductor's job to get them started really close together. So he tended to go, okay, let's go, and everybody press their buttons. Guys had really slow machines, they had to press those really fast. And then you'd hear, each had a snare shot at the beginning, and you might hear like that, and go, okay, I've got to start over again. Let's try again. That's better, but let's try again. It had to be within, I think it was less than half a second that all these things would line up. If they lined up like that, he knew that he could play with this, that could get this approximation of the original recording. So once that happened, and it was almost always the case that the little yellow hat that's in the center of the back there, he's the snare drummer. He was always the guy that was always seemed to be on top of the thing. So the conductor's paying attention, they're standing around, notices this guy's his snare went first. He sends him way back in the field. The reason he's doing that is because sound takes time to travel, unlike light, which also takes time to travel, but it's not the amount of time that we can notice unless we're astronomers and do that whole thing about how long it takes for the, 8 minutes for the light from the sun, et cetera, et cetera. Sound you can notice in things like this room, reflection of my voice in this room, that it takes time to travel. So he sent that guy way back so that his sound is going to take longer to get there. So although he was ahead of the beat, he's going to be on the beat or behind the beat, the snare at that point. And he sends the other musicians off in different places. He sends them out in a stereo pan. And he starts pushing and pulling them. And as they go back, he also gets them to get louder so that their sound will carry more over distance. And he tries to get them in this approximation of a funk band playing out in this open field with these back blasters. And he had all these kind of great things where they would get so far off in time that they kind of go up and they do that thing that put like two guitar players playing together so they kind of hook up again. There was a really nice section where they all spun around and had the Wesley effect on it, the Doppler effect. And I think we can. No, let's just start it up there. I think we skip ahead to the next one here. Yeah, this is the guitar solo guy. So he's panning across the field. Everybody's running around. So you can have this panning guitar sound. And, I guess that's an audience. No, that was the harmonica player. And what was really funny was, I mean, they could have just stood there, even still, but they really wanted to be like the rock musicians. So. here they go, the Leslie effect. So it was fun. So the first performance was on Toronto Island, that's where that's from. Time to Hear from Here is at the Royal Ontario Museum. If you walk in the front door and go past the gift shop into the next door, there's a randomized and very complicated and detailed thing that's on there. But every once in a while, there's this choral piece called Qui. I'm really, in this case, really sorry, we can't hear the sound for this. Laurel McDonald, who is my choir master for making the choral piece, just made a video that was shown in the last Nuit Blanche, and I was just happy to hear in the last couple days that it was the audience choice for the best piece at Nuit Blanche, and she re-videoed a lot of the singers for Qui. Qui has 29 singers in it. Each of them represents a different nationality that's represented in Canada and a different language. So although they're singing this coordinated motet, they're all singing in different styles and different languages. And you can hear that every hour in different forms. It tend to be thinner groupings, like you just see women here in the morning. And there's a full-blown Qui, I think, at 5:07 every day. So that's something that's best not to go to the internet, but go to the Royal Ontario Museum and see that. This I'm not going to suggest you wait for, but this was commissioned, and this has absolutely nothing to do with thunderclouds at all. The last one probably doesn't either. But you're supposed to see this fish every once in a while at the corner of Yonge and Dundas on the big screen there, the biggest screen they have. And I've only seen it. We got to play them all together. I did 6 videos for that screen. I saw them for the first time this last Nuit Blanche this year. But every once in a while, this fish named Frank. This is between all the movie trailers and the ads they show on the screens. Frank, and it's called Frank's Last Turn. Frank is dying in this video. But he's also heading down towards, that was the end. For some reason this thing just keeps jumping to the end before it's the end. He's heading down towards the AGO. So we had these two fish, Frank and Gary, and they were bought in Chinatown that morning and they were not very well. So Frank got eaten that evening by a gardener outside the film studio. Absolutely nothing to do with thunderclouds, but it's on this PowerPoint lecture, so I'm talking about it. In case anybody asked me, the other people who are doing stuff now that I don't seem to be doing as much thunderclouds stuff, I was going to recommend various people, including Wobbly, John Lydecker, Donna Summer, my name is Jason Forrest. DTQ, he's going to be pretty hard to find. He's this young Quebec guy. It's really fantastic. I'll play you examples of these guys, but no problem with anything else. And unfortunately, they're all white guys. This guy is not, I don't think. Does anybody know about Kudiman?
Yeah, YouTube.
Yeah, he's very popular on YouTube. I think it's just worth looking up Kudiman stuff. And I think I may have attached a Kudiman video here. So what's happening in this Kudiman things He finds people who are playing usually solo instruments on YouTube, completely separate things. And he puts them together in these really funky things by, you know, cutting, snipping, and getting them to line up. So this drummer here is Bernard Purdy, very famous funk drummer. And these other guys have nothing to do with it at all. The guy who's playing the bass keeps talking about what these guys should be doing. So these guys are sitting here listening, although they're just completely separate things. And eventually, and then, you know, people who can hardly play become this really kind of great funky brass section. So you can sort of hear, right? It's all separate instruments that he's put together from YouTube videos and stuff. Fantastic. Now this is the room of the harmonica players about to come in the shot and sing and be the singer on top of the whole thing. Kudiman. He's from Israel. We're back to the beginning. Any other questions, comments? Please hold the requests because we don't have a very good sound system in here.
I have a question. You said early on you weren't sure if you were allowed to do this, this sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And now you've done quite a lot of it.
I just figured out how to get sound. I'm pretty sure that would work. Yeah. Let's go back to Kudiman. Sorry, what is the question?
Groove just straight.
Go!
You'll be amazed.
Okay!
He's doing the talking. Together a live band that plays that particular number and other ones in Israel. It's pretty good too. Sorry, you had a question. It was you.
Yeah.
Or a comment.
No, it was a question. So, we live in this world with these laws and these lawyers and these good people and this kind of stuff, and it's changed over time.
Yeah. I'm one of those glasses half, it's three quarters full, even when it's only half full kind of people. So it seems like a pretty good world we're living in. Yeah. Once again, there hasn't been anybody complaining about us doing this kind of stuff since, I think Negative Land had a lot to do with it. And I think they did a really kind of great job of making it seem silly to go after little guys who aren't making money, who are doing crazy things like, and I think that, in a different way, something like YouTube is a huge, big business kind of thing. But most of the activity on YouTube, which doesn't benefit from the business end of it, is this sort of thing. Kudiman's appropriated all sorts of other people. In this case, it's not famous people. It's just one of those other people that really would, well, probably would love to be in a band like the Kudiman Band, and now they are. So in a way, he's doing the reverse of what I did, although he's doing the same kind of technical manipulation to make something that's artificial, that's, I think, at the same time, fantastically human. Which doesn't answer your question at all, but... Should we get out of this dim room? Should we continue to talk a bit more? Should I revise the lighting plan at all?